First Baptist Church. We are very happy that you're all here today. We'd like to say there's no strangers here, only friends that we haven't met yet. If you're visiting with us, we ask you to please fill out the blue visitor card or get one from the ushers and place it in the offering plate. There are also prayer request cards available in the pews. If you would like to add a name or concern to the prayer list, please fill it out and place it in the offering plate. Let us prepare your hearts and minds for worship as we listen to the musical review.
Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
And as your Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who offend us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
The responsive psalm appointed for today includes select verses of Psalm 51, beginning on page 520 of your pew Bibles. We read responsively Psalm 51, verses 1 through 12. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love. According to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions.
Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin.
For I know my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me.
Against you, you alone have I sinned, and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are justified in your sentence, and blameless when you pass judgment.
Indeed, I was born guilty, a sinner when my mother conceived me.
You desire truth to me in your deed. Therefore teach me wisdom in my secret heart.
Purge me with hyssop and I shall be clean. Wash me and I shall be whiter than snow.
And let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones that do in the flesh rejoice.
Hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquities. Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me.
Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and sustain to me the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
From the book.
reading from the Gospel according to John, the 12th chapter. Now among those who went up to worship at the festival were some Greeks. They said to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and said to him, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." Philip went and told Andrew, then Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus. Jesus answered them, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly, I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Those who love their life will lose it, and those who hate their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. Whoever serves me, the Father will honor him. Now, my soul is troubled. And what should I say? Father, save me from this hour? No, it is for this reason that I have come to this hour. Father, glorify your name." Then a voice came from heaven. "I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again." The crowd standing there heard it and said that it was thunder. Others said, "An angel has spoken to him." Jesus answered, "This voice has come for your sake, not for mine. Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be driven out. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself." He said this to indicate the kind of death he was to die. This is the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. I would now invite the children to come forward for the children's time. Good morning.
Good morning.
How are you today?
Good.
Can anybody tell me what this is?
An acorn.
An acorn. Good. And so what do you do with an acorn? What is an acorn? It's a thing that falls from the tree. Good. Good. What else? Somebody tell me more about an acorn. It's a nut. That's good. What else? Squirrels eat it. That's good. That's good. What happens to an acorn? What why does it fall from the tree? Why is it there, Alexis? It's a seed, Alexis tells us. Do you know what comes from an acorn? Alexis, what comes from an acorn? An oak tree. All right, so everybody get a good look here at the acorn, right? This is an oak tree. An oak tree, right? So, where's the acorn? Where did it go?
At the bottom of the tree.
The acorn is in the bottom of the tree? Can you point to it? You see an acorn there? You've got great eyes. Does anybody else see an acorn there?
No.
So what happened to the acorn?
The acorn grew.
The acorn grew. And when it grew into something else. You know, our relationship with God is a lot like an acorn. We come to church and we experience God, and we start out like an acorn. And because God loves us and we spend time with God, we begin to grow. And grow into something so much bigger and so much different than what we once were as little acorns. In a big oak tree makes new acorns. A big oak tree holds out its arms and lets the birds rest in it. A big oak tree lets the squirrels play and gives so many of God's creatures a home. And God's love in us is just makes us grow in exactly the same way. We start out small, and then we grow into generous, loving, and kind people. Let's pray. Loving God,
loving Thank God.
Thank you.
Thank you.
For the miracle.
For the miracle.
Of the acorn.
Of the acorn.
Help us.
Help us.
To grow.
To grow.
Into what.
Into what.
You want us to be.
You want us to be.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
To the time of congregational prayer, I call your attention to the names and concerns printed in your bulletins for today. Among them, Dan and Meredith Bouchain, Andrea Cherry, Ashley and Peter Colarossi, Agnes Dillon, Donna Faya, Ann Felch, Paul Griffin, Kathy Harris, Dava and Emma Kilbride, Reverend Florence King, Josephine Klein, Graham Baum, David Matatal, Jermaine Milord, Paul Nichols, Lori Pitsley, Luba Schneider, Mary Ellen Sherry, Joan Union, and Debbie Williams. Are there others we would mention today, or other causes for which we would give thanks? Bittersweet opportunity to pray for a very special family in our congregation. Rachel and Isaac are expecting to add to their number. Juven is going to have a sibling soon, and which is a wonderful, wonderful opportunity to pray for. But they will be heading to India later this week, and Isaac will be back in about 2 weeks, and Rachel will return in about 6 months after the new baby is born, and she's had time to recover with her parents as well. And so I would, before we begin our congregational prayer, I'd like to invite any of the diaconate and others to come forward, and Rachel, we will, with your permission, we will have special prayer for you now.
You can sit.
right, I would invite the diaconate to come around them and to lay hands on them. Let us pray. Good and gracious God, this family is precious in your sight. Give them traveling mercies that they may experience a safe journey. Guide and bless Rachel and all who will be ministering to her and taking care of her in the days ahead. And while Isaac has returned to us and must be apart from his family, we pray that you would increase their bond of love. Uphold him and her and Juven with the prayers of your people, and inspire within this congregation the desire and will to reach out to Isaac and to minister to his needs. We ask these things through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Rachel, I anoint you in the name of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Isaac, I anoint you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. And Juven, I anoint you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray. God, you made us in your own image and redeemed us through Jesus, your Son. Look with compassion on the whole human family. Take away the arrogance and hatred which infect our hearts. Break down the walls that separate us. Unite us in bonds of love and work through our struggle and confusion to accomplish your purposes on earth, that in your good time all nations and races may serve you in harmony around your heavenly throne. Let us pray for the world. Mighty and merciful God, from whom comes all that is good, we praise you for your mercies, for your goodness that has created us, your grace that has sustained us, your discipline that has corrected us, your patience that has borne with us, and your love that has redeemed us. Help us to love you and to be thankful for all your gifts by serving you and delighting to do your will. Let us thank God for all the blessings in our lives.
Oh, Lord, hear my prayer. Oh, Lord, hear my prayer. Hear my soul.
by bread alone, but by every word that comes from your mouth. Make us hungry for this heavenly food, that it may nourish us today in the way of abundant life. Through Jesus Christ, the bread of heaven. Amen. Please be seated. Quitting a bad habit is hard to do. Most of us have something in our lives that we know we should not do, or that we do not want to do anymore. From what we put into our bodies, to the ways we let our minds and words dwell on certain things. One of the most difficult habits to quit is smoking cigarettes. Every year, about 2 out of every 5 smokers try to quit, but only 10% are successful. Some people try to quit cold turkey. Some use behavioral therapy. Some use medication or nicotine replacements. Some use prayer and meditation. And I'm not trying to tell anyone that they should quit or to judge them today. That's not the aim. I'm simply saying that it's hard. Laws try to help too. Taxes on cigarettes are high, and smoking is banned in public places. And still, with all of these measures in place, on the whole, 1 out of every 10 who want to quit are able to do so. Those are not good odds. And a variety of studies have been done trying to figure out what works best. According to 2 recent studies from the National Center for Biotechnology Information, the most significant factor in people being able to quit smoking cigarettes had little to do with health. It had little to do with willpower or medication or money. Even the laws do little more than inconvenience people or to shame them. The most significant factor, according to these studies, that allow people to stop smoking was entering into a new relationship. It's true for romantic relationships, and it's just as true for entering into a new group of friends or the arrival of a new child. The greatest motivator to stop a bad habit is not willpower or money or law. It is the bond of love shared with others. The path of love has the power to change a life. This story is true in my own family. My grandfather smoked from the time he was 12. And 50 years later, he stopped the day his 7th grandchild came home from the hospital. I was the first, by the way, and clearly not quite sufficient. What years of inconvenience and expense and nagging and laws could not accomplish, the promise of seeing a grandchild that no one expected could do it. This is why 12-step programs for other kinds of addiction are so positive and see such great results. New relationships and the accountability that they can bring can give us power beyond ourselves. They give us power because love, the power of interpersonal love, is the only thing that can really change our hearts by connecting us to something beyond ourselves. Our lesson today from the book of the prophet Jeremiah is about the power that can change lives. Jeremiah had a challenging call. As a young child, God said to him, "I will appoint you to over the nations and over kingdoms. I will appoint you to pluck up and pull down, to destroy and overthrow, to build and to plant." The old covenant that God had with the people of Israel was not working. The old system of laws written in stone tablets were good, and they were holy. But they no longer reined in the impulses of the people. Those who had power and money took advantage of the system to make life harder for those without. And when they disregarded the law of God, people suffered, particularly the most vulnerable. The poor, the orphans, the widows, the immigrants and refugees. And so God spoke a new word through Jeremiah and promised a new covenant. The old covenant was based on external laws, do's and don'ts written on tablets of stone. And in the words Alexis read from the lectern just a few moments ago, Jeremiah spoke of something else. I will put my law within them. I will write it on their hearts. And I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another, or say to one another, "Know the Lord," for they shall all know me, from the least to the greatest, and I will forgive their iniquity and remember their sin no more. As Christians, we read this text through the lens of Jesus Christ. God knows us better, more intimately than we know ourselves. But through Jesus, God comes to know us in the languages and experiences we understand. Through the person of Jesus, we see who God is and how God interacts with humanity. The demand of God on the lives of God's people was never about following rules. Because rules can be misinterpreted and twisted. They can be manipulated. A person can follow the letter of the laws and twist them into something totally different, unrelated to the reason behind them. Jesus summed up all of these laws in one simple commandment: love God and love one another, because you cannot love God without loving one another. In this new covenant, the law and the reason for the law are not left to interpretation. It is written in the tablets of our hearts. Unless a grain of wheat falls to the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain, Jesus said. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. After his death and resurrection, the stories of the life of Jesus have spread through the world. And 2,000 years later, we are still digging deeply into the Gospels, learning about who he was and who he continues to be. We come again and again to this living document to hear Jesus speaking to us today. Our relationship with him moves us to love others as he loved us and to act in the world as he acted. Laws create order, but they cannot move people the way that love can. It is through our relationship with one another that we are changed. The love of God, written in the tablets of our hearts, enables us to live out the promises of our faith, the promises of our baptism, to seek and serve Christ in one another, loving neighbors as ourselves, and striving for justice and peace on earth. The good news of the love of Jesus Christ is our greatest treasure in this world. It is God's gift to us. And those of us who know it, who have received this gift, are called to be God's gift to the rest of the world through how we conduct ourselves and through the love that we show. What are the bad habits of the mind and the bad habits of action we need to break free from as a collective people, as a society. We have allowed polarization to infect every facet of our common lives. What would our world look like if the followers of Jesus stopped trying to win people over to their sides and instead sought to build relationships across every boundary that would divide us? How would conversation and debate in our country transform if Christians would lead the way in stepping out of our enclaves of people who look, act, and believe like us in order to enter into meaningful and lasting relationships? In order to break these habits of the mind, to address the polarization and hate to which we seem to be addicted, we need to invest in one another. We need to grow in love. This is hard work. It is hard to build relationships with other people, especially those who do not think or act or believe like we do. But it is our love for one another that has the power to change. This love can only be found in relationship, in community. It is not external. It is deep within our being. And Jesus Christ, the love of God that transforms the world, is written in our hearts. Amen.
Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself.
and of your own we give to you. Bless these gifts. Bless all who have given, and bless all who will receive through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Son and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen.